When I was a student pastor, I taught a high school small group and of boys, and probably one of the most impactful things I've ever done in my life was for years teach that small group. And during one season, I had this guy who helped me teach that small group, and his name was Alan. And he was like really high up in the Kentucky National Guard, and do his military, and just a wonderful dude. And he shows up at small group one night with these two boys, Daniel and Earl. And man, they look like, you know, they were from a different county, very rural, and they're just skinny as bean poles. And they show up. We always had food at that small group. That was like kind of the highlight of for a lot of those kids. And those two boys ate, and they ate, and they ate. And I'm like, oh my goodness, there's not going to be anything left, which is okay. It's fun. And they ate. And so, man, we began to get their story. And over time, this is what we found out. There were four kids, and their mother abandoned them when the youngest one was like 9 months old. And the little girl, her name was Emma. And their dad, at that point the mom abandoned him, he just really gave his life to raising those kids. And he worked super hard at raising those four kids by himself. But he really, think about this, single dad living in a very rural place, had a really hard time making money. And so the more we began to learn about their family, we learned that we would take them home and we would see their chore list and the things that they did. I mean, it was really like stepping back into time. No indoor plumbing. They didn't have a house. I mean, it was literally more like a shack. You're talking no insulation. Very much lived off the things that they could either harvest, catch, grow themselves. I mean, it literally was like walking back into time. They rode the school bus. Their ride to school was like 35 or 40 minutes. And man, you just would hear, I would talk with these two young men and just see like they just lacked so much that we lose when we don't have both parents in our life, when we don't have a mom. Well, Alan and his wife just got it on their hearts that like we have to do something about their living condition. Something has to be done. And so as a church, we started kind of figuring, well, what could we do? And it came up that one of their family members had this old rundown trailer a couple miles from their house. And it was on family property and it could be deeded. And the family member was willing to give them this old rundown trailer. And so as a church, I got to lead this project as a student pastor, but I was kind of led on the missions team. And one of our local missions outreaches, we said, we're going to flip this trailer. And that was back in the time of like the flipping show where they'd say, move that bus, you know. Extreme home makeover. This is like extreme trailer makeover redneck edition. And so literally we go in there and we flip this trailer. I'm talking, we put insulation in it, we put new floors in it, we do windows, we have to fix the porch, we put a fireplace, we do all this stuff. And man, it was awesome because for a month, it took us a month to do it, we kept Danny, the dad, away, and our church came and we flipped this trailer. And it wasn't just like, you know, a few of us doing it. I mean, literally probably 50 to 60 people from our church over time showed up to clean this trailer and this piece of property. And it was awesome. And it was very much like, it was very much a miracle. Like if you saw the before and after pictures, you're like, holy smokes. I mean, it went from like barely being, we couldn't literally live in it, to being way nicer than what they lived in. And man, I got to be there every day and work every day, and I got to really minister to that family for years to come. But I'll never forget a conversation that happened after we gave them, revealed to them and took them to kind of that move that bus moment, like, this is your new home, here it is. Literally, hours and hours and hours had gone into it. $10,000 had gone into it. Sacrifice in a lot of other ways had gone into it. And I sat down with Danny, and this very hard, somewhat calloused man who'd seen the wrong end of the world, the hard end of the world, looks at me and in tears says, "Why? Why? Why us? Why me? Why this? Why you? Why?" And I just simply said to him, "Because I love Jesus, and Jesus loves you." It's the answer. "Because I love Jesus, and Jesus loves you." As I prepared to talk about service this week, I did a little research, and volunteerism is essentially where the secular world will travel overseas to do some sort of volunteer work, tour work, also mix it in with some vacation. In some ways, it sounds like church mission trips for teenagers, but for lost adults. I began to search, why volunteer? Why do a volunteer? Why serve in that way? And here are the answers. And I just invite you to do this. You should look it up. Go home and Google, why volunteer? Here are the top answers, and you're not necessarily find them in this order, but these will all be near the top. It's good for your health. That's proven. There's research behind this. Why volunteer? It is good for your health. People who spend time volunteering tend to be healthier, both mentally and physically, than those who aren't. It's good for your health. That's one of the number one reasons you'll find to why volunteer. It's good for your health. Here's the second. Improves employability, aka looks good on a resume. That's why you serve. That's why you serve, to improve employability. Now, as a student pastor, I would often get two things, and both of them just rub me the wrong way. The first would be college application-wise, right? They're filling out a college application, or they want a scholarship, and so they're trying to dig in to get a scholarship, and so they want some sort of proof. They need proof, and so they need the youth pastor's signature that they've served in the church. Well, man, some people come who've served a ton, and have, you know, that's no problem. That doesn't bother me at all. But there are other people who, like, you read what they've written, and they just want you to sign off on it, and it's a lie. You haven't served, but you want the ability to serve. Now, there's one thing that's worse than that, is when a girl's trying to get into a pageant or be a part of a beauty pageant, and that the stuff that they come up with to sound good on a beauty pageant resume. Y'all think I'm making this up. It's like, it's not. It's like this gives off this ability of improves employability. It gives off this, hey, I've served, I've helped in the community, and so I've done this thing as a stepping stone. I have served to help myself. And the third, it brings relationship and connection to others. And this is true. I feel like this is true in the church. This is one of the things that I read. I was like, well, man, that is true in the church. Like, if you really want to belong to the church and be in the church and you serve in the church, it brings relationship and connection to others. But written in the way that it's written, it's like, again, it looks like I serve because I'm getting something out of it. Now, in this series, Proclaim, we're talking about why we proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're talking about our mission statement as a church. I just really think it's important that we always ask, whether in your job, in your home, in your church, you should ask the question, why are we doing what are we doing? Asking why is a fantastic question to ask, and the church needs to ask why. And the reason the church should do what it is doing is because the Bible says so, before the Bible tells me so. That needs to be the reason behind the why. And so just quickly reviewing our mission statement. And I want everybody to know this. I want everybody to be able to sit down in a normal conversation and say, yeah, this is my church's mission statement. And there's a shortened mission statement, and we do this so that you can remember it. And it is this: we glorify God by proclaiming Jesus Christ. I want you to know that. I want you to know, when you think Overland Church, you need to think we glorify God by proclaiming Jesus Christ. But there's a longer that's a shortened mission statement. There's a longer, more full mission statement. And I don't necessarily want you to have this memorized, but I want you to know the four things in it. And so we exist to glorify God by proclaiming Jesus Christ in order to make disciples who serve and multiply in their community and spread the gospel to the nations. And so when we unpack that, there are four values that come out of that: proclaim, disciple, serve, and multiply. I want you to know those. Now, this is what we would say about a church and their mission statement. It really can only say certain things if it's going to be biblical. Now, we can say it different ways and we can emphasize different things, but we really have just a few statements in Scripture that drive the mission of the church. The Great Commission that we normally go to, Matthew 28, Acts 1:8. And then there's the weird uncle. Anybody have weird uncles? All of mine are weird. Here's the weird uncle mission statement, the one that you don't hear preached that often in church. It's Mark chapter 16. Now, there's a few reasons for this. There's not going to go into all the reasons for this and the ending of Mark and how the earliest manuscripts didn't have this ending, but then we get a ton due, and it's enough that they put it in the New Testament. So I can just tell you, I believe this is God's Word. I have no problem preaching this passage of Scripture, even though in a few ways it feels like kind of our weird uncle. Now, if you will, in your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. I kind of feel bad for calling anything in Scripture weird uncle, because it's not. It's not really weird uncle. We just kind of think of it of it that way. It is no doubt God inspired in my mind. And so this is Jesus, the ending of Mark. Man, our boys, one of our discipleship rhythms that we have is that we listen on the drive to school. We listen to the Bible through this podcast called Streetlights. And we just finished up Mark this week. We just finished up Mark 16. You're disagreeing with me? We did not finish it this week? No, we finished it. They're going to disagree. It's James' birthday today, by the way. Everybody say happy birthday to James when you see him later. 10 years old. Lots of trouble. He's a man. Anyway, Mark chapter 16. Starting in verse 15, he said to them, "Go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents with their hands. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick, and they will recover." Now, here's the first point that I want you to get. And it is this: service will accompany proclamation of the gospel. Service will accompany the proclamation of the gospel. Now, really what I'm focusing on here is the end of this, right? Because we get go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Like, this is our marching orders to proclaim the gospel. This is the good news. The gospel is the good news that while we were sinners, Christ Jesus died for us. That those who place their faith and trust in Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection will be saved. This is the good news of the gospel. We can talk about everything what the gospel is. We do it all the time. And so I think we've got a grasp as a church on what it means that we preach the gospel. And those who do it, those who believe in it, it is faith in the gospel that saves. It's faith in Jesus' work. That when we do that, our first step of obedience is baptism. Baptism doesn't save you. It is an outward expression of an inward confession. It's proclaiming to the world, I'm following Christ. It's proclaiming to the world, I'm buried with Jesus. I'm literally going into the tomb. I'm being raised to walk in a newness of life. The other thing that I would just point out here is that you are either you hear the gospel and you believe it, or you hear the gospel and you reject it and you are condemned. And so then this is what he says. This is like what happens. We go and we proclaim the gospel. And those who go and proclaim the gospel, these things will accompany them. These signs will accompany those who believe in him. It's weird. This is why I joked about it being the weird uncle. We'll cast out demons. They'll speak in new tongues. They'll pick up serpents with their hands. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick and they will recover. Now, one of the main things that I think this piece of text is showing us is that when we as Christians are on mission, God goes before us. When we look at those things about casting out demons and getting bit by snakes or drinking by deadly poison and that not stopping the mission, that not stopping the person, what we see is God's power going before the Christian. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time here because I'm going to preach through the book of Joshua starting in a few weeks. Not just me, but our staff will preach through the book of Joshua in a few weeks. And the book of Joshua, the title of this sermon series is going to be God with us, God before us, God in us. God with us, God before us, God in us. And because what we see in the book of Joshua is God's power going before the Israelites. And so we're gonna look at that in the book of Joshua, and then we're going to see even how God in us moves in the New Testament Christian after the resurrection of Jesus, okay? So I'm not going to spend a lot of time there. Here's what where I'm going to spend my time today, and here's what I want to show you, is that the proclamation of the gospel births belief. God's word doesn't return void, and when it is preached, the result of the proclamation of the gospel is that people believe the gospel. Now, I'm not saying everybody believes the gospel, obviously, but at the preaching of the gospel, people place their faith and their trust in Christ. It's the good news, and people believe the good news. And when belief is born, it produces service. What God works in your heart works out. That was one of my points from last week. What God works in your heart works out. And we're going to talk about how those works are works of service in a minute. But this is the next thing I want to show you, is that then God working in your heart and it working out produces proclamation. So it's a cycle. Proclamation it bursts belief, and belief bursts service, and service births proclamation. It is a cycle that happens. Now, I would show you in Scripture that this kind of cycle of proclamation, belief, service is true for Jesus' life. If we were to flip through the pages of the four Gospels, we're going to see Jesus coming and really turning the world upside down. We're going to see him preaching a totally different kingdom. We're going to see a king who came to serve others, not to be served, right? That's what we're going to see. We're going to see a king that does it. And we're going to see a king that doesn't proclaim his own kingdom. He proclaims his Father's kingdom. He comes proclaiming this good news of the kingdom, and then you're going to see in his proclamation, what does he do over and over and over? He heals the sick. He ministers to the poor. He feeds the hungry. He heals the leper. Like just over and over and over, you're going to see these stories where Jesus stops and he's compassionate and he serves. Now, This is radical. I want you to understand this. This is radical. There's no king who's letting a leper anywhere near him. There's no king who's letting a poor man anywhere near him. Right? There's no benevolent king in the history of the Roman Empire or any of the other empires that's just so benevolent and cares for the people that he would stoop down and touch them. This is radical. Jesus' service was radical, and you will see that the proclamation of the gospel, there's going to be service with it. This is true for Jesus' life, but I want to show you this. It's also the pattern for the rest of the New Testament. When we read the ending of Mark chapter 16, reading the ending of Mark chapter 16 in some ways is like beginning reading the book of Acts, isn't it? Because what do they do? What do we see take place in the book of Acts? Right? We see this continuation of Jesus' ministry, and it's no longer just Jesus doing it. Now it's his apostles doing it. That they cast out demons, that they, at Pentecost, and they spoke in tongues, and people from every nation, different nations that were there, could all understand each other, and they could speak a common language for the purpose of the proclamation of God's word. You'll see that they'll pick up deadly servants with their hands, and they get bitten. Man, what does that make us think of? The Apostle Paul, after the shipwreck on the island, what happens to him? He gets bit. He gets bitten. And he lives and he survives. And so this is what we see. This is what we see unfold in the New Testament. They will lay their hands on the sick and they will recover. And so, man, I don't want today to necessarily like go into those gifts and those things and talk about throughout the New Testament how we see those things begin to change as time goes on. I'm not a complete cessationist believing that all gifts have stopped being by any means, right? But if there's somebody out there who can do those things, like I believe in demons. I believe that you can cast out demons. I just happen to believe that our demon is money in the U.S. You know, I think those things have begun. They've changed over time. But what you see is all those things are acts of service or God's power going before them. As I mentioned, we're going to talk about God's power going before him in the book of Joshua. So today I want to focus in on service. So I believe that we see this service will accompany the proclamation of the gospel is true in Jesus' life, and it is the pattern of the rest of the New Testament. Now, here's the next thing I want you to see, is that when we serve others and proclaim Jesus, we bring God glory. Now, book of Matthew, chapter 5. Man, there is so much that you can talk about from the book of Matthew when you want to talk about service. So much Jesus said about service was in the book of Matthew. Now, familiar passage. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, you are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So here I think is this picture of I won't go into the full analogy of salt and its saltiness, but like this is why he's put us here, is to be the salt of the earth. He's put us here to be the city on a hill. He said, hey, we're not going to light a lamp and hide it. Rather, we're going to light it and let it light up the house. So people are going to see your good works, your acts of service. They're going to see your, not just your acts of service, I believe this encompasses more than that, also the way in which you live your life for Christ, but your works, it definitely doesn't exclude that, and they're going to give glory to your Father who is in heaven. It is very much, I would just go and tell you, that whether it's a story that took a month of my life of flipping that trailer for the Thornton family, or if it's going to Haiti and helping to establish and build an orphanage, or if it's helping a couple who's run out of gas right up here on Horsetooth, or was at college rather, that in all those situations, those acts of service have let people see that I love Jesus. One Sunday afternoon, we'd left church and we'd gone to eat, and it was raining, and this car had run out of gas on College, and its emergency flashers were on, and they were right before one of the car dealerships up there, and I jumped out, just quickly jumped out, and because the boyfriend is like in the back pushing by himself, and he's like not moving the car. This small detail, it really doesn't matter, but I'm going to brag anyway because runners brag. I had done a long run the day before. My legs were dead. And so I hit that car with him, and I just start pushing beside him. He just like sees all of a sudden there's a dude pushing beside him. And we push the car up, and they turn in, and I'm like sweating bullets. I was just shot. It was like way harder than I thought it was going to be. And they're like, we need some gas. And I was like, hey, just stay right here. I've got a gas can on my truck. I'll be back 5 minutes with the gas can. I bring it back. The first thing that I'm putting the gas in the car, and the girl goes, you're a Christian, aren't you? I went, yes, I am, actually. Why? She knew that this is the type of things that Christians do. This is the type of service that Christians do. This is part of jumping in, as literally thousands of other people drove by. Who jumps out but Christians? It's who we're called to be, that we want to live a life that brings God glory. Now, at that moment, I just want to point this out. Like, at that moment, I'm not saying that, like, she's used to that, right? But that wasn't necessarily the proclamation of the gospel, was it? That was me pushing a car down the road. My point being, good works accompany proclamation. Service without proclamation isn't fulfilling the Great Commission. Now, there's nothing wrong with it. It's a step in the right direction. There'll be often times that we stoop down and we stop and we serve, and we won't have this full experience of being able to share the gospel. But we for sure can't stop just at that act of service. If we want to bring glory to God who's in heaven, we've got to let that whole light out from under that bushel. We've got to light up the whole house. And the full way of lighting up the house is by the proclamation of the gospel. We've talked in the past 2 weeks. I've been in Romans 10 where we've said, like, how will they believe if they do not hear? You have to hear the gospel in order to believe. You cannot believe in order to hear. So our aim isn't to make the world a better place to go to hell from. It's not. The social justice movement, I preached a sermon in Acts 3 and 4, I believe it was in June of 2020. And so it would be worth, like, if this is like for you, you're struggling with how do we deal with acts of service and acts of social justice or ministries of mercy and the proclamation of the gospel, I would just tell you to go back on our YouTube page and scroll a long way down till you find Acts 3 and 4 in June of 2020, and there's a greater explanation there. But this is what I would say is, like, our ministries of mercy, I say that to kind of distance itself from a social justice movement that in the 70s and 80s abandoned the gospel. Our ministries of mercy, our acts of service, have to come with the proclamation of the gospel. So there's a paradigm here. Good works accompany proclamation. Good works, service without proclamation isn't fulfilling the Great Commission. But at the same time, I want to show you something. Proclamation without service is dead. James chapter 2, verses 14 through 18, he says this: what good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warm and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. And so, ultimately, in my point, I want us to see is that these two things go together. We can't merely say we're going to serve others and not proclaim the gospel. If we're going to fully let our light out, if we're fully going to light up the city, we're going to do both. We're going to proclaim Jesus and serve others. Now, in some of the stuff I read this week in studying, somebody's PhD at Baylor University, and I was reading a piece of their dissertation. I know, it was a really, really happening week. And in there, they talk about basically how cities begin to look at churches who serve as social utilities. That means cities have with the crumbling of government programs, as governments have tried to figure out how they should help the poor, the widow, the orphan, right? As those have crumbled, that they've not worked, they begin to look to churches to be the social utilities, and all of a sudden, there's value added to have churches in their community because they serve. And so they'll tolerate their beliefs in order to get the services rendered to the community. Now, that's okay. You can view me as a social utility. I want you to understand our church, the church, is way more than a social utility. It is not just about serving the community, though we do. It is about lives changed by the proclamation of the gospel. It is about salvation. It is about the fullness of what happens when we say we have faith and our works prove it. I would just point to our church, and I would just point to the very beginning. We have always had a heart to serve our community. We've always had a heart to help the poor, to help the needy. Our partnership with Serve 6-8, like most other churches, man, I just would praise God for Serve 6-8 in our community and how they have done such a good job of keeping the gospel central. If you ever sit down with Mike Walker and have a conversation with him, and they have been pushed by governments and other entities in order to receive funding from the federal government, essentially lose the gospel, and the response is, never. We don't need your money. Right? We don't need you. We're the church. We're going to be the church. And so we can help you, but it's going to be on our terms. So we do this. This has been the heartbeat of our church from the beginning. I think about when we were at a place where we didn't have manpower. We didn't have the ability to do the toy distributions and the ministries that we're able now to do. And if you think about our Thanksgiving distribution, our toy distribution, you're talking about our church that in its acts of service rivals some of the largest churches around. That our people step up to serve. That in this period of COVID, that a lot of churches have had a hard time getting people to serve. And we've had 100 people serve this year. Do the math. Like, if you're thinking, like, look around, our church isn't that big, right? It's not. We got a lot of babies too. We got a lot of kids, right? And so for us to have 100 people serve, what's it telling you? Most of the people in our church have a heart for service, have a heart to serve the Lord. And so it's a huge part of others. And so why do we do it? We do it to bring God glory. It's what happens. And so here's what I would just tell us, that we must steward well how we serve God, that we must ask that question, why? And that personally as a church, that we're committed to serve to bring God glory, but there has to be an aspect that's like to the individual, a call to good stewardship, to steward it well. We preached through 1 Peter last year, and here was a couple of the verses. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. As good stewards of God's very grace, whoever speaks is one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves is one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To Him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. And so you see this call for individuals to steward the gifts well that God has given them. And that is what makes a church tick. It's what makes a church work, is that when you set up, there's a lot of stuff in the church. So if we're going to serve the community, we're going to serve around it, it means that first we have to be able to use our gifts together. When we first started, we first planted, we had this conversation this week talking about kids ministry. We would have these guys, neither one of them are here, so I'm going to talk about them. Diego, who moved to California a few weeks ago, and Ben Crawford, who is actually moving to California also, but he's in Illinois right now. These two guys, they were great dudes. They loved the Lord, and they were absolutely awful at working with kids. But do you know who was back serving in kids? Often, anytime they were asked, Ben Crawford and Diego. Why? Because they wanted to serve, and they knew it was a place in the church. It was a need in the church. They serve. Now, at some point as a church plant, we kind of got to this spot of like, okay, we're still like almost in like, we got to have people serve, and there is a criteria, and they have to pass a background check, and they've got to go through the teacher training, but they don't necessarily have to be gifted at it. To a place of like, all right, we have some people who are gifted at it, but we still have to have some people who aren't gifted at it. That's just the stage we're in now, all right? We've got some gifted people, but we still have to have some non-gifted people. We want to move to a place to where we are helping our people discover their gifts, discover how God has gifted them to serve, and then deploying them into environments where they can serve within their gifting. Now, we're not off out of the place where we don't need people to serve in kids, because by all means, we do. We have 56 people who have passed background checks and all that, who can serve in kids, and 17 of them are unavailable right now. And I don't just mean because of COVID. I mean because of other things going on. And so this is what I would say. We need more kids workers. We're always going to have to say that. We need more kids workers. We need more people to serve. But we're at this place where we're saying, okay, we want to steward it well. We want to steward how we serve well and how we bring God glory well. And so here are just a few things that I would say. I would remind you of the parable of the talents. And here's just write this point down. You've got to be faithful with a little before you get a lot. That's the parable of the talents. You can look that up. You can read that parable, that we need people who will be faithful in the small things. In today's world, so many people want to walk in and walk right up to the big task. They don't want to do the small task. They want to do the big task, like they've arrived. This is not how the world works. Listen to this. This week, Jennifer looks at me, and she says, when you were in college and you lived in an apartment with five guys, did you leave your shirts on the couch? I had a shirt on the couch. And I said, I thought about it for a second, and I thought about how nasty those guys were. And I was like, no, I didn't. And she said, why not? I said, because I didn't own that house, but I own this one. And I took off my shirt, and I threw it on the couch. I walked in the other room, and I quickly tucked my head, walked back in there, picked both shirts up off the couch, and went and put them in the laundry basket. Right? We don't just get to walk up and flex and say, because I own this house. No, we keep it neat and tidy, and we serve others, and we do it in low ways. Listen, you have to be okay with taking out the trash. Like, you think about it. I want you to understand, it does not matter if a man is the CEO of a company, has all these employees, and when he is in his home, is he not going to take out the trash? He better. That's all I got to say. He better, right? You are not above stewarding little things well. You have to steward the little things well. And I'm just going to tell you right up front in our church, if you are going to, we're going to unveil our at our serve team gathering on Saturday night, we're going to unveil our new leadership pipeline, and we're going to roll all that out. I'm going to explain all of it. But no one starts at the top. Everybody starts at the volunteer level. You start at the very bottom. And so what you're going to see is that there are pastors in our church who still, you're going to look at ministry, you're going to see their name in a volunteer space in a ministry. They don't just get to show up and rule it because they've been here the longest, or because they showed up and they're gifted, or they're talented. One of the biggest blessings you can have in your life is a church that when you arrive there and are eager to serve, makes you ride the bench. Makes you work in the little things to prove that you're faithful to big things. So that's it. I want you to be faithful to the little and expect to be faithful to the little before you get a lot. Then, here's the second thing. I want us to get to a place where all of our people are seeking out the gifts that God has given us, that they seek to discover them and then seek to grow in them. This is one of the other things we'll be talking about in our leadership pipeline as we unveil it, and how we're going to apprentice and how we're going to train so that we can find our gifts and grow in them. I would just quickly plug the upcoming women's ministry event on February 6th. During that, this is one of the things they're going to be talking about, is discovering gifts and growing in them. Jennifer wrote this basically like gift survey that's like not cheesy, because most of them are cheesy. And there's, I read it this week, and I was like, man, that's really, really good. At some point, the men need to like chase the women like we always do, and we need to do kind of the same thing. Like, I would plug that for the women. Go to that. I would also just quickly plug the serve team gathering to make sure that if you served in our church, come to that. Now, if you're got, you know what, I've never served at the church, but I'm really interested, I'm going to pitch something to you real quick. We need some people who don't haven't normally served at our church to serve at the serve team gathering. Okay? And so we would love for you to come and serve at the serve team gathering. If you've never served in our church, you can email my wife, jennifer.thurman@me.com, and she can set that up. I see Aaron and Rose sitting out there, right out there. Last year, Aaron and Rose had never served in our church. They came and they served at the serve team gathering, and then this has been a year in which they've served in our church. Aaron playing keys, Rose kind of on our finance and counting checks and entering and doing all that stuff. Like, they're using their gifts in the church. So also Aaron back there with tech. So I would just pitch that. Now, here's the next thing. I mentioned this last week, and I mentioned it in terms of both disciple-making and proclamation. But there is definitely the need here also that we would seek to serve intentionally and instinctively, both things. I'm stuck on this, that there has to be intentionality about how we serve. That means we have to make space on our calendar, right? There's a lot of people who have a heart to serve, a want to serve, but when they look on their calendar, they look at their life, they have no space to serve. Now, I want you to understand, every calendar, every man's walking in different shoes, and everything isn't the same. There are different seasons, right? There are different seasons of your life, and there are seasons with little small babies. There are seasons with crazy things at work. I get it, and I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. Right? I'm not. This is not a guilt thing. I don't want to be service to be guilt-driven. But I want us to be good stewards in that we look at what we have, and I would just argue that time is our greatest resource, and I would ask you to look at your calendar and go, do I have room to serve? And if I do not have room to serve, what plan can I put in place so that I have room to serve, room to show up, room to spend? Man, if you're here on Sunday mornings, I would guess that you've got room in your calendar to serve, because we're here for 2 hours on Sunday morning, and there are ways in which to serve on Sunday morning. So there, I would say there is a way and a time to serve. There are one-off special events that we have as a church that you can take off time from work to do. You can find ways, you can find time and make ways to serve. And so I would invite you to do that. And it needs to be strategic. It needs to be where our gifts are. So it has to be intentional. I would say just financially even, it has to be, you have to weigh in, you have to think through your finances and how you're using your finances to serve the Lord, to steward those things well. But also, it has to be instinctive. It has to be see the need and meet the need. See the need and do the thing. See the thing and serve. I would just say, if you've got questions about how do I do that, just go ask Ken Stratton. I'm not sure how he does it, but I just know that all the time, Ken Stratton is the man. He sees the need and it gets done. And I'm like, who did that? And then as soon as I asked the question, I realized I didn't have to ask the question, because I know that Ken did it. Because he instinctively saw that something needed to be done, and he did it. We've got some of those people in our church. Learn to do that. Learn that when you're driving down the road and you see this opportunity because somebody's broken down on the side of the road, or there's some sort of need that you can meet, meet the need. You do that, I think, by this, being in tune with the Holy Spirit. And I would say intentionally and instinctively that you have to be in tune with what the Holy Spirit is doing. We'll talk more about that in our Joshua series. Here's my last challenge, and it's to ask why. If you really want to steward serving well, you have to get the right why. Matthew 25, I told you there's a lot about service in Matthew. Matthew 25, it's the passage that we often call the least of these passage. Jesus says this, and man, this is a passage where he's bringing judgment, and he's saying some people are going to heaven and some people are going to hell. He says, "For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me." Then the righteous will answer him saying, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly, I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me." And I would just simply tell you today that we must serve Jesus because we love Jesus. The very same thing I told Danny. Why? Danny's sitting there in tears and he's asking why. And my simple answer is because I love Jesus and Jesus loves you. Love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Love Jesus as he loves them. Love Jesus because he loves you. Love your neighbor because he loves you. Today, I would just invite you, and we're going to sing a song of response. I would invite you to give your life to serving Jesus. Today, if you've never placed your faith and trust in Jesus, you've never followed Jesus, you've never given your life, today I would just tell you, confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised his Son from the dead and you will be saved. For the believer in the room, I'm going to tell you this. I say this often. The greatest thing you can aspire to be is a servant. Aspire to be a servant who proclaims the goodness of God for the glory of God. Father, we love you and we praise you. We thank you that we get to serve you, that it is a privilege. And Lord, I look at the things the world says. Why serve? And I look at what I get when I serve you, and I can't help but like go, all right, I want to serve out of place of being selfless. But at the end of the day, I get you. And there's nothing greater than getting you. There's nothing greater than being loved by the one who breathed the world into beings, who spoke the stars and the heavens into existence. So, Father, today may you be glorified. And may we, your people, be enriched by your love and care for us. May we be enriched by your love and care through the other saints to us. That we would live a life that looks beyond ourselves and looks beyond others, but looks to you. That we may love others as you love them. Father, we love you and we praise you. Amen. Let's sing a song of response.